in space among the stars, a great mystery has been discovered. A steady, unchanging, unending radio signal. What could this strange signal be? Could someone or something be sending it? In a secluded observatory high above the city, the professor and I have been listening to the mysterious sounds of space for many years, waiting for some sign that would lead us on a journey to the stars.
Calm down, Sniffer. I can hear it. Sniff, bring ICU to here. I'm going to need some help with this.
Yes, what is it?
Come here, ICU 2. Well, what do you make of these readings?
It's not space static this time, is it, Professor?
It most certainly is not static. Static is random noise, eh? But this, well, this is a regular signal. In fact, I believe it's another pulsar.
But it's not behaving like the others. Are you sure it's a pulsar?
Oh, it's a pulsar, all right, but a very special one.
How is this one different?
This pulsar is moving. In fact, it appears to be orbiting.
Orbiting? Are you sure?
Come, look for yourselves.
Oh, my. It is orbiting.
This is what we've been waiting for, ICU 2.
At last, our journey to space can begin.
Now let's see. I'll plot the course tonight, and we'll pack first thing in the morning and blast off by nightfall.
Professor? We can't possibly leave tomorrow. The ship must be fully inspected and refueled, and we definitely shouldn't attempt a journey like this without an in-flight maintenance robot.
Maybe I have been a little hasty, eh? But I am very excited about this. If we can prove that this pulsar is a message from beings in space, well, it could be the most important event of all time.
Oh, I totally agree, Professor. But that's all the more reason for us to properly prepare for this journey.
Well, you're right as always, ICU 2. I'll tell you what. Tomorrow morning, we'll go downtown and we'll buy one of those new space robots they're selling nowadays. How's that sound?
Sounds great, Professor, and much safer. And so it was decided we would travel into space to investigate the source of this mysterious signal. But what will we find? Is this signal really a message from intelligent beings who live in space? Or is it the strange electrical effect created by some gigantic spinning star? Next morning, the professor and I headed directly for the robot store. All we needed was a qualified space robot to assist us with our preparations, and there was no question about where to find one. The world-renowned Spears and Robot Company. It was here that we would find the most highly sophisticated and advanced robots that money could buy.
Oh, you clumsy pile of nuts and bolts. Can't you do anything right?
I'm awfully sorry, Mr. Bellows.
Please, spare me the excuses, Norman. Just get this mess cleaned up, okay?
Yes, sir, Mr. Bellows.
And try looking where you're going once in a while. Do you understand? Must you always be so careless?
No, sir, Mr. Bellows.
Yes, Mr. Bellows. No, Mr. Bellows. Just get the stuff out of here, would you please? What would our customers think?
They'd probably think I dropped something.
Don't talk back to me. Just do as I tell you, and we'll get along fine.
Uh-oh.
Oh, good morning, folks. Come on in. We just had a little accident here. Watch your step. My name's Bellows. Bill Bellows. What can I do for you?
We're here to look at one of those new space robots. One that can help us with a difficult and important journey into space.
Space robot, eh? What'd you want to do? Trade in this old GP unit?
Trade? I see you too? Oh, no. I wouldn't dream of it.
Good, good. These old models are worthless now. Nobody wants to buy them. Now, most folks just take the computers out and convert them into planners, coat racks, lamps, things like that.
My good man, I have no intention of becoming a coat rack. I am a perfectly serviceable unit with over 127 modifications. Why, I can't believe
sure,
that you would...
Sure, don't blow any fuses. I didn't mean to upset anybody. You just have to be a little careful in this business. People come in and try to unload junk on you as trading. Like that D5 over there. Took that as a trade-in? What a mistake.
Look, Bellows, I'm not interested in trading in my good friend ICU-2. Now, we're here to look for a space robot. One that's suited for spaceship maintenance and spacewalking. Do you have one or not?
Sure, sure, no problem. We're the largest supplier of robots in the world, you know. Come on over here and take a look in this catalog and pick out the one you want. You'll find the space robots back here in this section. Excuse me a second. All right, Diode Head, what's the problem? Something out there more interesting than your work?
Oh, I'm sorry, I...
Pick these up and put them where they belong. And try not to drop them again, eh? Stack cartons C through L on shelves J through R.
Uh-huh.
And cartons M through V on shelves S through Z. And
right.
Be quick about it.
Yes,
we don't have all morning.
Of course, sir. I'll get on it right away. Let's see now. That's cartons J through L on shelves M through V. No. T. Oh, wow.
Look, ICU-2, I think this is the one we want. The model CS-1000 space travel unit can pilot courses and do space walking. Oh, that's the one we're looking for, all right, eh?
CS-1000, great choice. You'll love it.
How soon can we expect delivery?
Well, let's see. On this model, we can have it for you in 3 to 6 weeks.
3 to 6 weeks? Well, we can't wait 6 weeks.
Oh, you can if you want this robot. We get him right from the factory. There's no way I can get one any sooner.
Oh, no.
Oh, my.
I don't believe this.
Oh, I'm in trouble now.
You know, Professor, maybe there is something I could do for you. Would you consider a slightly used model?
I don't know.
Look, I can guarantee you'll have it first thing in the morning. And it's just as good as the CS-1000.
Oh?
Believe me, it's the perfect robot for you. And I can let you have it for half the price. And now, how does that sound?
I would rather not postpone this trip any longer.
Good, good. Then it's settled. Just leave everything to me. I'll take care of it personally. Trust me.
Yeah. The new robot has arrived, Professor.
Oh, it's finally here.
Sign here, ma'am. Thank you.
Certainly. Oh, what a large crate.
I can hardly wait to see what he looks like.
Oh, me too.
Just think, our own space robot.
Oh, yes.
One that can help us with maintenance and spacewalks and who knows what else.
Oh, so exciting.
Hello, remember me? My name is Norman. You have no idea how happy I am to be here. What can I do first? I clean kitchens, bedrooms, dens. I do a great job on windows, and of course, my specialty, bathrooms.
Bathrooms?
Yes, sir, my specialty. Where would you like me to start?
You mean you're not programmed for spaceships?
Oh, no, sir. I'm a domestic service robot, Sirius D5A.
How could such a mix-up possibly happen like this, eh?
I have a feeling there's more to this than Norman is telling us, Professor.
Is that right, Norman?
Well, I think what really happened is that Mr. Bellows sent me here to get rid of me. He thinks that I'm useless and that I never do anything right. But I do. I do lots of things right.
Well, I'm sure you're a very competent domestic unit, Norman. I had a feeling that Bellows was up to something. His trickery doesn't surprise me at all.
How could he expect to get away with a thing like that? I am sorry this had to happen, Norman. But, well, you just wouldn't work out. We'll have to send you back.
Oh, Bellis said if you send me back, he'd sell me for spare parts.
Oh, my. Well, we can't let Norman be dismantled. We could reprogram him, couldn't we? I'm sure he could learn what he needs to know about space.
Why, yes, of course I can. I learn very fast.
Please, Professor.
All right. You win, I see you too. Well, Norman, it looks like you're going to be a regular space unit, eh?
Oh, thank you, sir. You won't be sorry.
Well, you got a lot to learn now. And the first thing, we're going to have to bring you up to date about space. Agreed?
Agreed.
Very evening, the professor took Norman out under the stars and introduced him to the wonders of our universe.
Norman, hey, look up there. Isn't it spectacular, huh? Have you ever wondered about the moon or the sun or the stars, huh?
You know, I haven't. I've always been too busy. Floor mops, brooms, and dust rags are all that I've ever had to wonder about.
Then you're in for a real treat.
Oh?
Let's start from the beginning. You see, the sun, our star, well, it wasn't always here. Many scientists believe it had its beginning, well, 4 billion years ago. Well, back then, things were not as they are now. I mean, the sun and the earth and the other planets, well, they didn't exist. There was nothing but a big mass of swirling particles, a great cloud of dust. As the particles gathered in space, they began to collect together into a cloud. They crowded closer and closer together. Around the center of the big cloud, smaller clusters began to form and orbit. These would later solidify into the planets. But the main attraction was in the center. As the particles continued to get closer and closer together, the heat became so great that tremendous amounts of energy were released and our sun began to shine.
A new star.
Exactly. Now, remember those smaller clusters of particles, eh? Well, by now they had cooled down, forming the 9 planets that complete our solar system. Furthest away from the sun is Pluto. Then Neptune, Uranus, Saturn, Jupiter, Mars, Earth, Venus, and Mercury.
Wow, that's really something. Are there people up there on those other planets?
Oh, no, I don't think so. You see, conditions aren't right for life on those planets. You see, the Earth is a very special place and has a very special environment.
Oh? What's so special about it?
Here. Now, you take a look, huh? You see the sun in the center there with all those planets orbiting around it?
Uh-huh.
That's our solar system. In every solar system, there is a region around the sun we call the zone of life. It's a region that is neither too close to the sun nor too far away.
Too far away? Too far away for what?
For life to evolve. If a planet is too close to the sun, well, take for instance Mercury, it would be way too hot for life as we know it to evolve. Why, it would burn up before it even got a chance. On the other hand, if a planet is too far from the sun, like Pluto, it would be too cold. Life as we know it, well, couldn't even get started. Why, if it did, it would freeze up like ice cubes. But of course, if a planet like our planet Earth happens to be in the zone where the temperature is just right, well, then there's a good chance life will develop. Bushes, trees, animals, perhaps even people of one sort or another.
What about Mars? It looks like Mars is in the zone of life.
Well, we haven't given up on Mars yet. but the chances of finding life there are pretty slim. Not only is it too cold, but it doesn't have much water, and there's no air like Earth's to breathe. Most likely there are no forms of life greater than the tiniest bit of algae or moss. Our unmanned probes to Mars have failed to find even that so far.
You mean Earth is the only planet that has life?
Well, I wouldn't go so far as to say that.
Why not?
Well, we've been talking about our solar system, but there are thousands of others. Well, maybe millions, who knows?
Oh?
Now, you take a look up there. Eh? You see those stars?
Uh-huh.
Well, any number of those stars, and remember, they are also suns, any number of them may have planets orbiting around them, and many of those planets might be in a proper zone of life.
There's not much chance of that, is there?
A greater chance than you might think. Here, take a closer look, huh?
Holy cow! Look at this. What is it?
That's our galaxy, Norman. The Milky Way.
It's beautiful.
Oh, yes, it is. And our sun is just one of those stars. Just one tiny speck in that great pinwheel.
How many stars out there have solar systems like ours, with planets and everything?
That's hard to say. There may be as many as 4 or 5 billion stars in our galaxy that have planets around them that may support life. Think of it, 4 or 5 billion. And in many cases, intelligent life, too.
Then there must be a planet out there that's got people on it. There's got to be people out there.
I think so, too. When you think how many stars there are out there, well, the odds are overwhelming. And you don't even have to count the other galaxies, either.
There's others? Other galaxies beyond our own?
Well, hundreds of billions, we estimate, so far.
Oh, no.
Here, take a look for yourself. Each one of those galaxies could have billions of solar systems with planets in them that could support life.
Wow! That was beginning to frizzle my circuit. It's
fantastic, that's what it is. It's our universe, and nobody knows how big it is. Why, there may be millions of other galaxies out there. There may be trillions, who knows?
And we're going out there?
Yes, out into our galaxy.
Me?
Yes, Norman, you.
Oh, wow.
Oh, no, I think we've had enough for one night, eh? Well, we've got a busy day tomorrow.
Okay.
Now, here, you carry this, okay?
Tell me, how does this thing work, anyway?
Well, yeah, now, that's another story, eh? Well, come on, it's cold. Let's get out of here.
Preparing a spaceship for a 36 trillion mile journey is not an easy task. There are many important things that must be done, and some of them very carefully.
Don't touch that. Norman, get away from the sack. It's going to explode.
If that canister breaks, we'll all be blown to atoms.
Oh. It's the end of us.
Phew. That was a close one, eh?
It certainly was. Norman, you're going to have to be more careful, a lot more careful.
What is this stuff anyway?
It's antimatter, Norman, and it's very powerful. It's our spaceship fuel.
Why couldn't we use something that's not so touchy?
Perhaps you can explain, Professor.
Yes, well, I suppose that would help. Now, Norman, this pulsar we're going to is 36 trillion miles away, eh?
I've never been more than 10 miles from the factory.
Yes, well, this is a long trip, eh? As a matter of fact, if we were to use the rockets that our astronauts use to get to the moon, why, it would take us 10,000 years to get there.
Do we have that much time?
Well, you might, but I don't. I'm not a young man, eh? No, we have to find something that will take us very fast. Almost as fast as the fastest thing there is.
Oh, what's that?
Light is the fastest thing there is, eh? It can go to the moon and back in only 2 seconds.
That's the speed of light, Norman. 186,000 miles per second.
You mean we're gonna go that fast?
Well, no, almost. That's why we have to use this kind of fuel. So we can travel almost as fast as the speed of light. And even then, well, it will take us maybe 8 years to get there.
Let's see, 8 years and 8 years back? So that means it'll take us 16 years to make the trip.
Well, 16 years for those on Earth. But for us in the spaceship, it will take only, 16 days.
That's impossible.
Oh, no, it's not. It's called slow time. Now, we'll be moving almost as fast as the speed of light, so time will slow down. I know it sounds strange, but it's true. Now, try to imagine this, eh?
Say I hop into my little spaceship and blast off. Whoosh! There I go. Before long, I'm traveling at nearly the speed of light. I decide to travel at this speed for a couple of hours, a little vacation. So I zoom happily around moons and stars and planets. It's more fun than sweeping the stairs. Now, before I left, I promised myself that I'd be home in time to mow the lawn, okay? So at the end of my couple of hours, I zip back to Earth and land on the front lawn. But wow, look at this. It's a jungle. What happened? In my time, I was only gone a couple of hours. But in Earth time, well, I've been gone a whole year. Everything else on Earth is a year older, especially my lawn. Well, look at it. Why, it'll take another year just to cut it.
You know, I'm not so sure going into space is such a good idea. First you say there's all these stars and galaxies out there. What if we get lost? And now you say this time's going to go all crazy. Couldn't Sniff and I just stay here and watch the laboratory? We'd be all right, wouldn't we, Sniff? After all, I'm only a domestic robot. I don't think I'm cut out for all this space travel.
Nonsense. You don't want to stay back. You'd feel terrible if we came back with all those great stories and you weren't there. Besides, when we come back, you'll be famous.
That's right, Norman. We'll all be famous. If we're right about this pulsar, we'll be the first to discover life in space.
What do you say, Sniff? You want to be famous?
As Norman began his third day with us, things seemed to be going a lot more smoothly for him. Our first chore was to prepare a hearty breakfast for the professor. And no one was better at making breakfast than Norman.
Boy, do you really think we'll be famous?
Yes, we might, if the professor's theory is correct.
You know, with all this excitement and everything, I haven't had a chance to thank you.
For what?
For talking to the professor into letting me stay here and not sending me back to spears and robots.
Oh, that. Well, I couldn't send you back to that horrible Bellows character. Besides, I'd do the same for any old CD3 unit.
Oh, you would?
Oh, come on, Norman. I could see something special in your sensory orbs that showed me you were no ordinary domestic robot.
You could? Really?
Of course. Besides, I couldn't let Bellows take out your computer and sell you for spare parts.
Wow, that was a close call.
Now hold still. Okay, that's it. You're all set.
Here we go. All right. There you go.
Not bad. Now there's something a space robot sure couldn't do.
Here's your breakfast, Professor. I made it myself.
Oh, thank you, Norman. Just set it down there somewhere.
Where?
I'm sorry. It looks like things are a little cluttered up on my desk, eh?
More than just a little, I'd say. What you working on?
Well, I am plotting our course to the pulsar. Turns out it's a little more complicated than I thought, but I think I've got it all worked out.
Oh? What was the matter?
Well, according to my calculations, our course was taking us just a little too close to a black hole.
Black hole? What's a black hole?
Just something we have to avoid, that's all. Listen, do you have any syrup, huh?
Oh, yes. Got it right here. Here you go.
Thank you.
Are there lots of them?
Lots of what?
Lots of black holes.
Yeah, well, we don't know. They're difficult to find because we can't see them.
That's weird. What are they exactly?
Well, first of all, black holes is not a very good name for them because they're not holes at all. We think that they are giant stars that have died and collapsed.
I thought a star lived forever. How does a star die?
Well, some of them use up their fuel and fade away. Others, well, they just explode and the center part of them collapses.
Collapses?
well, maybe I better explain it this way, eh?
You see, we think that when a giant star runs out of fuel, it begins to collapse. It shrinks and shrinks, becoming smaller and smaller. At the same time, the gravitational pull at its surface is increasing. It becomes so powerful that nothing can escape its pull, not even light. The star is still there, but because no light can leave it, we can't see it.
But if you can't see them, how do you know they're there?
Well, one way is by the strange effect they have on other stars, like double stars, for example. Did you know that about half of all the stars we see come in pairs? Well, they do. They get caught up in each other's gravity, and they revolve around each other. Normally, we can see both of the stars, but sometimes we can only see one star revolving, and we can't see what it's revolving around. Well, we know it must be revolving around something. We think that something is a black hole.
Wow! Are they dangerous?
Oh, yes, I'm afraid so. Very dangerous.
I knew it. I had a feeling they meant trouble.
But we're not going to go anywhere near a black hole. Not if I can help it.
But what if we make a mistake and get too close?
Well, I'm afraid we'll be gone forever. Sucked up into the blackness, like cracker crumbs into a vacuum cleaner.
No way!
Norman, be careful.
I'm not going. No.
Norman, be careful, please. You might be over the fighting system. You're going to destroy it.
Wait, no.
Please, well, watch out.
I'm not going. No.
What on earth is going on in here? Norman, what are you doing?
The professor said it would be the end of us.
What would be the end of us?
Well, I was trying to explain to Norman about a black hole. But I'm afraid I didn't do a very good job. He thinks we're going to fall in one and be gone forever.
Oh, I don't think that's anything you need to worry about, Norman. Why do you think the professor's working so hard on these charts? He's trying to ensure that we don't run into a black hole, or anything else for that matter. Now look what you've done to the professor's study.
Oh, I'm sorry. I guess I got a little carried away. You okay, Sniff?
Come along, you two. Let's let the professor have some peace and quiet.
Norman, thank you for the breakfast.
Did you like it?
Yes, it was the best breakfast I've had in a long time. And I'm looking forward to many more on the trip.
Ah, thank you, Professor.
This was to be our last night on Earth for a long, long time. In the morning, we would begin our exciting journey into space. The professor and I were checking the final calculations for our course to the pulsar.
You know, I see you too. We should really see this. It's absolutely beautiful.
Yes, Professor, but what are the readings?
The readings. Sorry. We will go right past Saturn toward Proxima Centauri's 72 degrees. Now, how does that sound?
So far, everything seems to be fine. We should have the flight projections in just a second. Oh, my, that will never do. That route will bring us on a direct collision course with the planet Neptune.
Oh, really? Oh, maybe I better check that again.
Good idea.
Look at this. A show in space. I bet it'll be good for me to watch this. Let's see. There we go.
Good evening, and welcome to the Night Owl Theater.
Well, thank you very much. I'm glad to be here.
For centuries, we have pondered the existence of life on other worlds. What does it look like? What strange creatures could lurk about deep in the darkness of outer space?
I wonder.
Tonight's program, Space Monsters.
Space Monsters?
Would a creature from another world look like this?
That guy's not so bad. I'm not afraid of him.
Or might the denizens of space be even more menacing?
Ooh, what is that?
Can you imagine something like this touching you with its slimy, bubbly tentacles, huh?
Oh, no, that would be awful.
By early the next morning, everything was ready for the trip. But I couldn't find Norman. I looked everywhere for him. Finally, in the study, I found the answer. Oh, no! Professor, come to the study quickly. Norman's gone. I think he's run away.
What?
I've looked all over for him. He's nowhere around. I think he saw this TV program on space monsters last night, and it must have terrified him.
Oh, poor Norman. Alone out there. He must be lost by now. Oh, we've got to find him. But how? We don't know where he could have gone.
Why, I think Sniff's picked up his trail, Professor.
Really? His trail? I didn't know you could do that, Sniff. Well, let's go. We don't have much time. Tell me, children, have you seen a little robot about this high? His name is Norman, and he has his arms like this, and he walks around like this all the time. He kind of skates along. He's very cute, and if you saw him, I'm sure you'd remember him. Have you seen him?
Bye.
It's no use I see you two. I'm afraid that Norman is lost. We'll never be able to find him. Sniff, are you sure this is the right trail? All right. But give me just a minute.
You are to be a gas pump. All you've ever had to worry about is filling gas tanks. I bet no one has ever asked you to go out into space. You're safe. No space monster will ever get you. They won't get me either. Mr. Grimes said I could hide out in this junkyard as long as I worked. And that's just what I'm going to do.
Excuse me. Have you seen a robot like this, eh? A little blue robot like that, about this high, and he walks like that.
A robot, you say? Here in my humble junkyard? Oh, no. But I could make you a wonderful deal on a lovely old wood-burning stove.
No, thank you.
Come into my office here. You'll just love this wonderful old stove.
Professor, I think Sniff's found him.
Mice, just mice.
Let me go.
They're all over the yard.
Let me go.
There's nothing for you to bother about.
Stop it.
Uh-oh. Sniff, what are you doing here? Go back. Go away. Now, be quiet. Don't find me.
Too late, Norman. I see you.
Oh, no, I see you, too. Please don't make me go. I saw what's out there. Monsters. Terrible monsters.
Norman, calm down. We've been looking everywhere for you.
Monsters, bubbling, oozing monsters. They're going to get me. I won't go into space. I won't. Not even to be famous.
You're right, Norman. You're absolutely right. I agree with him 100%.
Yeah.
What good would it do you to be famous if you were floating around out there?
Right.
In a million pieces, a victim of foolish heroics.
Now, just a minute, Grimes.
Yes, Norman, just a minute. That's all the time it would take for some cosmic cretin to crinkle your coils.
Don't listen to him, Norman. He just wants you in his junkyard, to work you like a slave for nothing.
Norman, you know I have only your own good at heart, don't you? It would grieve me.
Yeah.
It would grieve me personally to know that you'd been crinkled and crushed by some loathsome beast out there in the black void. I couldn't bear it.
Oh, yes. Space monsters, right? Terrible creatures, eh? You better watch out, Grimes. They'll be coming after you. Coming after you from the awful, ugly world of the unknown. Ah!
Who am I?
Norman.
Now, you listen. Let me explain something, eh?
Right here on Earth, where we all live, there are thousands and thousands of different creatures, most of them living harmoniously together. A bird is quite different from an elephant, but elephants don't go around attacking them just because they're different. Norman, different doesn't mean bad. Why, even if I myself were living on another world, I'd look different. Supposing I was in a park that happened to be on Jupiter. Now, because of the size of Jupiter and its gravity, I might look like this. And a flower would look like this. Now, if I happen to live on a very small planet, one with a very light gravity, I might look like this. In this very low gravity, I could probably float around like this all day. Oh, a very pleasant experience indeed. Well, to continue. Our form of life is based on carbon. Yet it is possible that there may be life forms based on silicon. People like that would be glassy.
Glassy? Oh, those would be my kind of people. Classy.
Not classy, glassy, like windows. Watch. See? Other types of life might be atmospheric. Still others might be pure energy. Of course, there may indeed be the types with 16 arms and no head. But whatever form they are, I'm willing to bet anything that they will all be just as friendly as I am. I hope. Forget, Norman, that when we do encounter life forms from other worlds, think how strange we will look to them.
I guess I never thought about it that way before. When I saw all those terrible creatures on TV, well, I was scared. I didn't know what to think. I guess I forgot who my friends really are.
You're not alone, Norman. Well, we all forget sometimes.
Besides, we couldn't just let you go. Why, we had no idea what could have happened to you.
The important thing is that we're all together again, eh? Come on, let's get out of here, eh? And let's go visit our friends in space. Better luck next time, Grimes, eh?
Yeah, sure.
Come on.
But I'm not the one who's gonna need the luck. I'm not the one that's going into outer space. I'm not the one that's trying to be a big hero.
Hey, I'm not trying to be a hero either. I'm just trying to do my job. I'm still a little bit scared, but with friends like this to help me, I know I could be a space robot. Besides, I want to meet some of those classy people. Goodbye, Mr. Grimes.
Classy people, but what classy people?
Oh, no, Professor, not classy, glassy, as in window.
Yes, of course. Come on, come
on. Finally, the countdown had begun. We had spent the early morning hours taking care of the last-minute details, and now, at last, our journey into space could begin.
Let's see now. I turned off the light, shut down the heat, socks, shaving gear. I see you too. Did you lock the back door?
Yes, and I checked all the windows.
Good. Well, let's be going. And I keep thinking we've forgotten something. Maybe not. Let's get aboard. After you, I see you too. Huh? Now, where's Norman?
What?
Where's Norman? I don't see him anywhere.
Why, he was just here a moment ago. I thought he was right behind us.
Where could he have gone? You don't suppose he's running away again, do you?
Oh, Professor, I'm sure he wouldn't ever do that again.
Norman! Norman! We'll have to go without him. We can't stop the countdown now.
But we can't just leave him here.
Norman, just in time. Oh, where have you been?
The chart, Professor. We forgot the chart.
I don't believe it. I knew there was something.
Why, we would have been lost without those calculations. We would never have found our way to the pulsar.
We would have been lost without you, Norman. Good work.
Thanks, Professor.
We only have 45 seconds left till blastoff. Please, everyone, we must hurry.
Come on. Oh, what are we waiting for? Let's go. Goodbye, Earth. We'll see you on the way back.
Thank you.
spacecraft nearing light speed in Sector 4.
Yes, I see. It's leaving a 9-planet system.
Oh, and there seems to be 3 mobile computer units on board. Now, what do you suppose they're doing way out here?
I have no idea, but this is very intriguing.
Wait, I'm getting a life form reading. It's an intelligent being.
An intelligent being? Wonderful! We must begin preparations to make initial contact with these creatures.
Make contact? But what if they're not like us? What if they're dangerous?
Yeah.